purpose, and it to me is my purpose, and I'm really doing it.
I'm looking forward to this discussion very much today.
Yes, and we have a distinguished guest today. He is the host of the Esoteric Hollywood podcast and author of the upcoming book by the same name. He is also authored many articles that you can find at his website, jaysanalysis.com. I want to welcome Jay Dyer. How are you?
Thanks, guys. Glad to be here. It's a pleasure. Enjoyed your work as well.
Yeah, well, it's great to have you. And today on the show, we are going to all be reviewing the film Imperium, which just came out, limited release. I know that I watched it not in the theater, because I couldn't find a theater near here, oddly enough. But looking forward to reviewing with both of you. And Adam, why don't you give us a quick synopsis of the film?
Yeah, sure. So this is just something I stumbled across on YouTube. You know, the trailers were promoted on YouTube, and immediately, it set some alarm bells raising for me in terms of, like, it would be something really interesting to look at, because it is a film about white supremacist and neo-Nazi groups in the States, and basically follows an FBI sort of agent, informant, slash provocateur who infiltrates one of these groups to prevent, or perhaps to, incite them, towards terrorist activity. So, I mean, the film starts out, we see an FBI sting operation involving a group of Muslim recruits. So just before they actually go ahead and lay off the bomb or whatever it is, they are foiled, so they're stung. And it is shown that the character of Nate, an FBI agent, has one of his own informants working within this kind of cell. He may have even recruited this cell, but the actual terror attack is stopped. And he is congratulated by the FBI for this, of course, and they then tell him that they've picked up chatter, I think, or what you might call signals intelligence, involving other, political extremist groups within the States who looked as if they could be planning some kind of terrorist activity. Now, it's revealed that they don't really have any solid evidence or any solid leads on this in regards to exactly who might be doing what, but Nate is informed by his superiors that just because we don't have any solid intelligence, or just because we haven't we can't determine if there is a credible threat at this stage, does not mean it's not there, and we must go looking for it. And so he is then tasked with becoming a infiltrator into one of these groups. So he does his research on far right politics. He shaves his head, he's got skinhead, and he does all the research into the kind of anti-Zionist narrative, the Aryan supremacy kind of narrative, and eventually works his way into a sort of a low-level skinhead group. He rents out apartments and all that kind of stuff, and gives him stuff to cover. He's supposedly ex-military, got all these resources, he's running a medical supplies business, and slowly but surely he works his way into this kind of, I suppose what you might call that, the kind of white supremacist hierarchy. So it starts out with him getting to know these kind of skinhead street thugs at the bottom. He then is slowly but surely introduced to, the more senior members who are kind of like right-wing militias, and then that moves on to him becoming familiar with some of the more educated kind of upper-class conservative groups. And so we're sort of presented with a whole kind of, a hierarchy of types and socioeconomic strata, should I say, within this kind of, within this side of politics. So obviously his aim here is to find out who among these people might be planning a terrorist attack, who has the access to things like resources and weapons and all that kind of thing. What he finds out is that even the people like the right-wing militia groups seem to be more like posturing than anything else. They don't seem to really present any kind of a credible threat. But because of the pressure that's been placed on him by his superiors, and because of his, his desire to impress them, he basically incites them. After finding out that none of these people are really sort of political extremists, he starts inciting them, starts getting emotional with them, and finally, entrapped, I guess, the most kind of educated upper-class conservative among that group to go and source, bomb-making equipment and to plan some kind of an attack to start this kind of race war that, all of their kind of... All of their leaders have been talking about in this movement. And of course, before anything can actually happen, that they are stunned. So, the FBI come in and arrest everybody. So, there's the end of the story. But the film is interesting on a number of levels. We're looking at many different interesting kind of facets of the story here. I think one of the most interesting parts of this is the fact that the group that he infiltrates, again, are basically just posturing. They're talking about race war, they're using a lot of pejorative terminology, but not really that dangerous. They don't really take a lot of action. And the only action that is actually taken, which gets them arrested, is action that he himself both incites and facilitates through his resources, via the FBI. And, this connects into a lot of real-world scenarios and stories that we have seen over the, the last 10 to 20 years especially. I think more so in recent months, where you've got, intelligence operatives or kind of deep state actors infiltrating these groups, perhaps even recruiting the groups in the first place, facilitating some kind of, terrorist attack and employment. So, Jay, what were your kind of initial thoughts and observations upon watching the film?
Well, initially I was not too hip to watch the film because I thought, oh, here we go. It's just going to be total propaganda against any sort of conservatism to try to sort of box it into the distasteful image of neo-Nazism or the Klan or something like this. And there's a little bit of that, but not as much as I expected. It really just sort of functions as a kind of continual propaganda piece that we generally see from Hollywood when it comes to crime dramas and the FBI. That even though, like you said, the Nate character, played by Daniel Radcliffe, is really the one provocateuring and really involved in this, there is still this giant terror threat that's just looming. And so we've seen this recently in Hollywood with a lot of films that are willing to, be it the CIA or the FBI, they're willing to show a little bit of dirty dealings or some of the bad apples, perhaps, in the establishment. But at the end of the day, they're still the good guys there to save the day. They're still keeping us safe from all of the supposed terror threats that come in all sizes, tastes, and flavors. Or the Baskin-Robbins 32 flavors of terror. And this happens to be, of course, the white supremacist flavor. As a film, I thought it was a little thrown together. It was kind of, it didn't seem natural. I mean, aspects of the film in terms of the wardrobe, I guess, and the costumes were very well done, because if you see these kinds of groups or watch these kinds of groups that are portrayed in the film, they actually are pretty cartoonish. They're festooned in costumes and so forth. So in that part aspect of it, the art direction and so forth is pretty good. But the dialogue was very bizarre at times. It was almost like the mud people are coming. I've never heard any racial theorists speak this way. I mean, I'm sure I'm aware of racially derogatory terms, but I've never heard that one. So I thought that was a little strange as a picturing the pathology of how the persons of white nationalist flavor might speak or think. The other areas that were a little bit strange, the Yidda vision, I'd never heard that. I've heard Talmud vision, but I'd never heard Yidda vision, so that was a new one.
Yeah.
But other than a kind of milk toasty, goofy dialogue, I guess it was an average film. It was kind of, I guess, what we come to expect from Hollywood. And yeah, that's my just initial impression. I mean, I've got a lot of notes on kind of background and messages and memes in the film, but that's just my initial impression.
Well, before I hand it off to you, Aaron, on your thoughts, I just wanted to agree, because I guess my my thoughts before watching the film were very much the same, that I was expecting this to be some kind of a propaganda piece that was attempting to paint any form of conservatism or nationalism, or perhaps even kind of the more moderate fringes of ethno nationalism, as being violent, as being dangerous, etc. And although that is pushed in a lot of ways, I think the film did a fairly good job in being a little bit more nuanced than that. And the director actually alluded to this in a number of interviews, where he talked about the fact that it serves no purpose in going out there and doing a hit piece on people who don't agree with you ideologically. I think it's a more constructive to look at them as human beings, not dehumanize them, and to actually try and deconstruct the argument a little bit more, than you expect. But I guess not an amazing film, but I just wanted to add that and agree with you there. But I expected it to be a lot worse than it actually was. But Alan, what were your thoughts on this?
Well, I read that article that you're referring to there, Adam, where Radcliffe and the director are talking about how the whole point of this film for them was to start up a discussion about the whole neo-Nazi issue, and at least the title of the article insinuated that they wanted to try to get neo-Nazis or maybe like on the fence to change their minds about their views and come over to the other side, whatever that may happen to be. But to me, the film didn't seem like it would do that at all. Like it wasn't really a critique of any sorts of like white nationalism or anything like that. If a real neo-Nazi watched this, it wouldn't make them change their ideas whatsoever. It'd just be something I don't even know. But again, in the article, they were saying like, oh, yeah,
because of that ABC. I mean, what did you have to say about that?
Yeah, that's a very strange way to cast the film. I mean, I can see where they're coming from with the ending, where the young boy who is kind of caught up in the movement, later, I guess you could say, converts out of it and is speaking to a class of predominantly black students, and he says, I did this because of hate. And there's an interesting theme throughout the film that I'm not sure I really have a grasp on what they were trying to say, but if you recall several times, both Dallas Wolf, the kind of Hal Turner radio shock jock character, says, in the beginning was the word, and then the guy at the neo-Nazi compound says, something to the effect of it being all about the word, and then we end with the young boy that I mentioned saying, it all starts with a word. So there's some aspect of this to which I think they're trying to maybe portray the way that they've been talking about online radicalism, even though being online is not really what radicalized the characters in this film. We've seen this a lot in the mainstream media where, with you mentioned in the start of the show, we were talking about Dylan Stormroof. the story there, the narrative there began in the mainstream media that he was radicalized online. He read these websites. We saw this with Micah X, the radical black supposed alleged shooter in Dallas. He was radicalized online. We saw this with Christopher Lee Purnell. I forget what his name was, but he was one of the mosque guys from like last year, I think. And he was, quote, radicalized online. And so this is a trend that we've seen. And so I'm wondering if maybe the constant references in the film to the word that begins this, it seems to be that, you know, through some medium or through some form of message, and presumably the internet now, you know, especially with the character of Dallas, right? The word goes out, this new message, this awakening, quote unquote, that is what causes the radicalization, and then people, of course, feel a sense of victimhood, as you mentioned, and the film ends with the FBI handler saying, well, it all starts with victimhood, and that's the key to understanding fascism. Now, there's some truth to that, but there's also a massive amount of a massive amount of hypocritical contradiction, because when we consider the existing American establishment itself, which I have, I don't want to go too deep into that yet, but I mean, there's so much hypocrisy involved in that, with the establishment calling anything ever out there a fascist. It's utterly hypocritical. I mean, our government is the most fascist, because it's an insidious kind of subtle pseudo fascism that lurks behind the mask of democracy, and I think that's even more insidious. So, and you can point to a lot of instances of this too, where if you really start thinking logically and critically about these kinds of hot button issues, if you say, okay, well, what's presented in the film is the danger of fascism, then you start thinking, well, now wait a minute, the United States is a BFF with Saudi Arabia, one of the top funders in the world of terrorism. The Saudi Arabian autocracy is one of the most brutal out there. Wait a minute. We're starting to be a little bit hypocritical here. What about the funding in Latin America by the U.S. of so many fascist regimes, through CIA regime change coups? What about the funding of neo-Nazis, right sector, probably sector in the Ukraine by the State Department? I mean, it starts to get really hairy and hypocritical quick when we start going down that route.
With the word, it connects to Christianity. And, of course, with terrorism, it's about religious extremism, right? So these characters in the film are portrayed as religious extremists, although it's very subtle, it is, because they're talking about the film begins and ends with a word. Mm-hmm. Very cool concept there.
Well, so, John, in the beginning was the word, right?
Yeah. So they're equated with Islamic extremists, which are religious extremists too. So I don't know what you think about that.
Yeah, that is interesting. That phrase they keep on using, it all starts with the word, because, as you say, at the beginning of the film, I think they that there are a number of quotes. I can't remember exactly which scene this happens in, but it all starts with the word, this is repeated throughout the film, and it also ends with it ends with this phrase, it all starts with the word. And so what we see at the beginning is that neo-Nazism, right-wing extremism, this kind of thing, this all starts with the word. And then we fast forward to the end of the film, where the young skinhead, the thug basically is reforming, he's rehabilitating, he's giving these motivational talks to the schoolroom full of black kids. And then he says, something along the lines of, it all starts with the word. And I think he seems to flip it on his head in terms of what it actually means. Like, the way into this is with the word, and the way out of this is with the word. So, with the very cause, the root of this ideology starts with words, and the kind of the exit door of this ideology, and, back into, liberal progressivism, top of the word as well. So it's kind of interesting that they, use that same phrase, because it doesn't really explain kind of what they mean by that.
Yeah. Right.
That's basically saying, the word is seductive. The word is the thing that will twist your mind, which will, seduce you and kind of brainwash you into adopting these kind of philosophies. But then the word is also the thing which will allow you to sort of see the light and get out of it at the end. So I thought that was interesting. And as you stated before, Jay, it is kind of confusing the way in which they do that, isn't it?
Yeah, it's almost like the word is dangerous because it might be too attached to logical thought processes, you know, in John's gospel, for example, and that's used at the beginning, the logos, which is, of course, where we get the logic or logoi, which is the rationality of a thing. So, and I'm not positive, but I'm saying it could be that, you know, the message is, don't worry about reasoning through or logically considering these positions, rather fall back into emotive reactions, which is what, generally speaking, a film can do through storylines and through music and through dramatic scenes and so forth. It much more so. I mean, I'm not saying that all films are irrational or purely emotive. I'm just saying that it's a much easier medium of propaganda than reading, for example. I mean, reading an articles can be propaganda too, but I think the goal of Hollywood in terms of psych warfare is to shut off the rational thinking process, as is all psychological warfare, really, you know, all the way back to World War II leaflets. The goal is to shut off critical thinking and to get an emotive response.
Yeah. I think this is probably, maybe where they're coming from with this, because again, they really emphasize the point in this that the word is what leads to this kind of violent reactionary extremism. You know, I think that there's a lot of film, you know, sort of archive footage of neo-Nazi groups and burning crosses and Hitler and all this kind of stuff, and it's kind of alluded to that, well, the word is what leads to this. And if you're using the wrong words, if you're using reactionary extremist words, racist, bigoted words, what have you, it will always lead to this, you know?
Yeah, it could be the idea of censoring speech. I mean, that could be what...
Yeah. That's kind of what I'm getting at as well. And of course, you know, as I said before, the same can be applied to the flip side, you know. So it can go the other way too.
Exactly, which is where it's very, very slippery slope when we really start to consider any time the establishment. I'm going to say that this movie is coming from the establishment. I think it obviously is. You know, the green guy who this is based on, of course, is if you can research that, he actually is part of a Soros organization. And I looked it up the other day and I forgot, it's the something Law Center, Berenson Law Center, or something.
I had it just up a
few. Yeah, I did, and I X'd it out. But you can find that easily if you Google it. But if we really start to look at that and say, well, okay, now wait a minute, you know, what's the establishment's line in any sort of big political, again, as I said, hot button issue, it's very easy to deconstruct it when you have some semblance of kind of wider metascope geopolitics. You know what I mean? I mean, it's known that Soros organizations funded the right sector in the Ukraine. And if that's the case, you know, to get the color revolution there and to get the coup, well, then it's very, it's just a completely dubious, I doubt that the people involved in this film are aware of that, but I mean, are the neo-Nazis good or bad? It's the same with Al-Qaeda. Is Al-Qaeda good or bad? I mean, yeah, exactly.
What about the counter-protesters that are portrayed in this film? Because they kind of fit into that whole thing that we're talking about here, too. What do you think about them, Jay?
Yeah, it reminded me actually of a recent event with some of the, I guess you could call them white nationalists in San Francisco when they had a bit of scuffle with the Antifa, the Anti-Fascist League. So you've got two sides of a coin here of what I would argue are just completely unrealistic approaches to ideology. I mean, both of these groups are, and as I'm sure we're going to touch on, any kind of radicalized group like this, I think, is really out of touch with the realpolitik or the way the world really is. Excuse me. Because you just can't. I mean, that's why these kinds of groups often appeal to young people, is because young people are idealistic. So, you know, Mao's Cultural Revolution, for example, it appealed to the youth to, you know, destroy traditional Chinese culture for the revolution. And we see this pretty consistently with any kind of radical movement, be it far right or far left. If you look at Pussy Riot in Russia and Ukraine, I mean, this is this radical feminist Western NGO-funded
provocateur group of so-called musicians who are really there to just run around with their, you know, breasts bared and saying kill Putin and stuff like this, and that this is all intended to cause a stir and to, you know, kind of, as I said, provocateur. And it's geared towards the youth. You know, this is obviously not going to change the mind of somebody who's 50 years old, but the youth are much more pliable, and the establishment has known and understood that for a long time. I mean, I've been lecturing through Carol Quigley's Tragedy and Hope, and he says several times in his text, you know, that revolutions have always been the purview of foreign banking interests or foreign governments. So, you know, that's when you see these kinds of things, you really tend to, you need to look behind the scenes and consider, well, number one, what is this group, be it Prabhu sector, be it Right sector, be it Antifa, be it Pussy Riot, be it any of these kinds of so-called democracy groups or whatever they are, or far-right fascist groups, and you need to look at where they get their money. And most of the time, now that we have the internet, you can find pretty easily, you know, what groups, corporations, foundations, think tanks are funding these as tools for some sort of social engineering, regime change, political coup, or whatever.
There's a whole spectrum, you know, in terms of the you know, groups both on the left and the right, linking to, you know, intelligence agencies, and linking to foundations, think tanks, even charities. So I guess there's something else we can talk about here as well, is the I suppose the real world kind of tie-ins to I guess real staged events, or events that were at least cases of like sting operations or entrapment. And one of the ones that comes to mind is something that you have talked about, Jay, a number of times, which is the Newburgh Sting. So this was a scenario involving an FBI agent. You know, I think this, it was the guy's name was Jay Dyer. I think he was a he looked to be some kind of double agent to me, because he apparently trained in Pakistan with the ISI over there, but at the same time I couldn't get any real information on exactly why, but he was also working for the FBI, because I think they had him up on fraud charges, and so, you know, they got him working for
him. Well, that's what happens. That's how you get brought into working.
Yes.
So you get trouble, and then you become a confidential /partner. Yeah.
Well, they search out these types of people. You know, people who are, you know, fundamentally narcissistic, who are good liars, you know, basically no scruples, you know, as was obviously the case with this guy. But what he did is he moved into this mosque in Newburgh. And I don't think he was really even heavily involved in the mosque itself, but he started to approach these sort of disenfranchised African Americans who, I think a number of them, it was four of them, I think a number of them out of the prison system for things like drugs and stuff like that, where they had previously converted to Islam. I don't think converted wholeheartedly by any means, but they said in interviews that, you know, this was something that you had to do when you were in prison. You know, you either joined a gang, and if you were white, you went the neo-Nazi route, or the only alternative was basically Islam. But so these were, you know, disenfranchised, disillusioned young men who were, you know, living in poverty, you know, not a lot of opportunity, and they were approached by this FBI agent who's staying here. He was flashing around money. He's got cars, you know, fancy cars, you know, fancy dresses, clothing, you know, jewelry, all this kind of stuff. And obviously they were instantly attracted to him, because he was offering them some kind of a life involving money, status, power, fame, what have you. And so he starts recruiting them, starts trying to groom them, and basically saying to them, look, you know, I'm rich, you can be rich like me, but we need to do Allah's work. We need to do, you know, we need to get involved with some kind of jihadi activities. And the sort of ringleader, I guess, the first guy he approached was, what was his name? Cromedy, I think his name was. And he got this guy Cromedy to start recruiting other people, because there needed to be a group, I think, of at least three or four people to pull off this fake terror attack. And, you know, this dude, Cromedy, was trying to back out of it. He was, he was obviously reluctant. He was not ideological or political by any means, but was, you know, lured in by the money. But because of this, you know, he did end up recruiting a number of other guys. And I think over the course of about a year, this guy Hussein eventually got all three of them to go ahead and try and plant a bomb outside a synagogue in New York, at which point the FBI moved in and arrested them. And despite the fact their defense, based the case on entrapment, and they met all the criteria for entrapment, given the fact that they had no prior experience in these matters. They had no prior intentions. They did not otherwise have the resources or the means to do anything like this. They were still given a mandatory minimum sentence of 25 years because there was a fake rocket launcher involved, you know, something like Stinger missile or something like that. Mm-hmm. And so this documentary, the Newburgh Sting, really, really shows you how this supposed, you know, foiled terror plot that was plastered all over the mainstream media when it happened was literally fabricated from the ground up. You had an FBI agent moving to a mosque. He recruited people who were in no way motivated or, you know, politically, you know, sort of idealistic at all, and simply lured them in with the concept that with the promise of money and fame and all the rest of it, only so that the FBI could sell them fake bombs and move in before they set them off. So I think there's a lot of parallels to that real life story in the film Imperium, because it's essentially what happens. We see the main character trying to essentially recruit and to groom people, and despite the fact that there are militia groups involved in this kind of greater hierarchy, they're essentially just posturing, and he has to really, really dig and motivate and sort of fire people up in order to actually get them on board. And then he himself, you know, gets his FBI, you know, contacts and the resources to supply, you know, these bombs, you know, at which point they're, you know, they're foiled and, you know, this thing goes ahead. So, yeah, I mean, this seems to be what we're looking at in this film. And this is one of the interesting points about this film, which I thought was, I suppose, the element that was probably the most true to life about it, was the fact that on one hand, we've got, as you say, Jay, I guess an establishment film. But on the other hand, they're showing you quite clearly that these people were guided and encouraged to do this in the first place, and then would not have done it had it not been for this FBI, you know, informant or infiltrator.
Yeah, I thought that the parallel was striking. And the other, I think, important thing to remember from the Newburgh Sting is the section of the documentary where they discuss the what Patrick Henningsen calls police state pageantry, which is where they had all of these Humvees and these giant vehicles and 100 cops show up for this bus with the FBI. And the guy in the documentary that they're interviewing, I think one of the prosecutors, says, oh, yeah, well, this was all done for the media. So this gives the impression that there's just all of these terror lurking terror threats out there. And all of this pageantry, you know, is sort of the justification, right? People see, most people are not looking into the incidents. They're reading or seeing, you know, a clip or two on the mainstream media that shows, you know, 100 cops and 100 FBI agents showing up to this event, which is pretty ludicrous given the fact that in the documentary they show that at every step of the way it's being filmed. I mean, every single thing that the provocateur and his assets are doing is taped. It's taped from day one, and you know they have cameras even stuck up in the trailer where he's got the so-called bazooka. They're even filming that, right? So every bit of it's filmed. So the idea that anything was even actually going to happen is negated by that fact. And it just stands to prove the famous New York Times editorial from a couple of years ago stating that almost all of the terror plots in the U.S. are hatched by the FBI. That's the front page of the New York Times. So, again, it's not, once you see this, it's really not hard to pick it out. And I would venture to presume that most of the big-scale terror that we hear on the mainstream media is probably this same situation. Now, they mentioned McVeigh in the film, which I think is important to talk about, too, because they don't talk about the fact that McVeigh was actually sheep-dipped and worked in black ops, which means that he is questionable as a supposed terror mastermind. That would mean that McVeigh was most likely more so in the role of the kind of character that Daniel Radcliffe is playing. Also, and I think it's important to mention Hal Turner, and there's a great piece over at LouRockwell.com called Prefabricated Fascists, the FBI's Assembly Line of Provocateurs. This is a piece from 2009 that I'll include in my show notes, and I think it's interesting because the film mentions Tim McVeigh being influenced by the Turner Diaries. Now, this is a 1978 fictional novel by William Luther Pierce, who is kind of a founder of one of these white nationalist neo-Nazi type organizations. And when you look into the character of William Luther Pierce, I think he's sketchy at best, given the fact that he comes from the establishment. He was a military guy. I'm trying to remember his exact role, but he had some sort of role in the military dealing with, he worked with the Los Alamos National Laboratory at Caltech. So he was obviously doing some sort of high level engineering work as related to his military service. And when you look at this guy, and any time that you see these sort of big military general, you know, deep state type people that are suddenly out there as, for example, William Luther Pierce played a big role in the John Birch Society. I think the John Birch Society is a very questionable organization, very sketchy and very shady. And when you consider the fact that Pierce was associated with George Lincoln Rockwell, who is the founder of the American Nazi Party, it gets even more shady because, as the Lou Rockwell article points out, most people who I think are competent researchers have come to the conclusion that George Lincoln Rockwell was some sort of COINTELPRO Fed or asset, or at least a patsy. So again, just like with the Klan or with any of these kinds of groups, you almost always find across the board, and that doesn't just apply to the white fringe, it also applies to black radicalism, Black Panthers, for example, with the KKK, there's the famous character of Gary T. Rowe, who was an open FBI informant and provocateur for the Klan. There's the character of Richard Aoki from the 60s and 70s, who was a famous FBI provocateur and informant for the Black Panthers. He's actually the one that convinced the Panthers to start walking around with guns, which made them distasteful in the media and kind of destroyed their image back at that time. So, again, any time that you come across a case like this, and I mentioned earlier McVeigh and Oklahoma City, that was connected to Elohim City, and Elohim City was, once again, this is public mainstream news, run by the feds. So that is another link in the reason to suspect that Elohim City and Tim McVeigh, the story is not what we're told in the mainstream media, but something else. Either how he was a patsy or he was playing the role of the Daniel Radcliffe type character, and then maybe he was executed, or maybe he wasn't. Maybe he was. Maybe we're told he was executed, and he was. You know, he's living on an island somewhere. I don't know. There's not probably any way that any of us are ever going to know for sure. But what we can look at is the contradictions in the stories that were told according to the mainstream media, and see the patterns that you mentioned with the Newburgh Sting. And again, it's always the same. I mean, I've got a whole page of notes here on this kind of stuff. When you look at the Patty Hearst and the Seminese Liberation Army, exact same patterns there. But I'll let you guys talk, because I'm rambling for a while.
Well, obviously, within the world of this film, Timothy McVeigh is basically a brother with these neo-Nazis, because, he read the same book. So he's coming from reading the same pages that they were. And so, he is linked to massive historical terror event. So in terms of predictive programming, is this movie perhaps playing a role in setting up white supremacy, neo-Nazism, white nationalism, whatever, far-right politics, setting that up as this new terror threat in a predictive programming sense? I'll throw that to both of you. I guess Adam first, what do you think?
Well, that is an interesting question, and I'm not quite sure about that, because from looking at the film, when I first saw it, looking at the trailer and then, first getting into the film, my initial suspicion was that this exactly what it was. This was some kind of an attempt to incite, racial and social tension, because, the film has come out within the past few weeks, and it's coming hot on the heels of, a number of racial
racially charged issue. So, you know, for a couple of years now, we've had rioting in the States. We've had, you know, the Ferguson scenario. We recently had the Dallas shooting, or exactly what happened there, I'm not sure. But again, these were racially and sort of socioeconomically charged issues. And so when this film came out, my initial thoughts were that this was, basically to try and incite people towards a kind of reactionary left-right dialectic. And it does that to a certain degree, I think, because it is, you know, I think at face value, it is presenting these people as having an ideology which most people would probably find to be reprehensible. And although they are guided and encouraged and kind of provocateured into this terrorist action, they still go, you know, they still are willing to go through with it. So they're still being told essentially that these people are dangerous, because with a little bit of encouragement, but they're quite happy to go and blow things up to start their race war, etc. But that, all that being said, again, it wasn't quite as inciting a film as I had initially expected it would be, because the arguments are not really refuted. They're not really deconstructed. One could almost say that if you were to look at the arguments that were being presented in the film, you know, all the causes that they are aligning themselves with and sort of promoting, on account of the fact that there's no refutation, I would imagine that, you know, a lot of people in, I don't know, perhaps the more extreme fringes of the alt-right movement or existing neo-Nazi groups would look at this as some kind of validation. And so as to how, let's say, a mainstream liberal demographic would perceive this, I guess that's a little bit more murky than I would have expected, because again, these people are definitely presented as being threats, you know, very much, you know, as the case, but at the same time, they're not presented as being, it doesn't go ahead and deconstruct the argument, you know, and so...
It's a little something for everybody, right? So something for the audience, yeah, which is presumably liberal, and something for the Nazis who happen to be watching, too. Well, what do you think, Jay? Is this somehow predictive programming to scare people in the audience that this Nazi terrorist threat is imminent in any way?
Well, it is interesting that you mentioned predictive programming, because one of the more well-known famous incidents that it makes Oklahoma City questionable is, of course, the book by Frank Keating, who is the brother of Oklahoma's, the governor of Oklahoma's brother. He wrote 4 years before the Oklahoma City bombing, The Final Jihad, which is, of course, the idea that the jihad ultimately is going to be white nationalists taking over, sort of like the Turner Diaries projects. And so in the novel Final Jihad, of course, Frank Keating wrote that Tom McVeigh would commit this terror bombing attack 4 years before Tim McVeigh supposedly creates the Oklahoma City situation. So that, I think, is a big indicator that the, you know, the Oklahoma City thing is not what we're told. It's a false flag of some sorts, and presumably would have been organized by black ops and so forth, including Tim McVeigh himself to whatever degree. And so in that case, I would say that's a great example of predictive programming, and it's very strange that they mention Tim McVeigh, you know, several times early on in the film as kind of being the beginning, I guess, of this new phase of the right-wing racialist militia that's now this new threat, burgeoning threat. So I would say yes, and honestly, I'm kind of surprised that we haven't already, because they really continue to play the, you know, the radical Islam narrative pretty consistently. You know, we think about the underwear bomber, we think about the military base one where the guy supposedly shot up the military base. Major Hassan, Nadal Hassan, that's it. The Major Hassan shooting at the base, the Christmas tree bomber, underwear bomber. I mean, it just goes on and on and on. So I'm surprised that we keep getting that narrative and we haven't seen more of the Dylan Stormroof style. We've only seen one or two of those recently. And it's weird because the film,
makes it out like these are just happening all the time. And oddly enough, the instances that the film mentions of these kinds of attacks, anthrax, I've never heard of a white nationalist, racialist getting a hold of anthrax. I mean, if you look at the history of anthrax on 9/11, that is actually from a government biowarfare lab, and I think speaks much more to a kind of false flag government situation than it does any kind of radical fringe group, because it, just like in the film, it consistently presents cesium and radioactive materials coming from Africa. I mean, come on. What middle class white American actually has the contacts to get cesium brought into the country from Africa? I think that's completely ludicrous. Also, the narrative of dirty bombs that we've consistently heard since 9/11. I mean, where are the dirty bombs that are going off? The only bombs that go off are the ones that tend to go off in the fake ones, the 1993 World Trade Center bombing that the FBI did. That one didn't even go off. It was a fake bomb. The bombs that go off are the bombs that go off in Indonesia and Turkey and Bangladesh. Those are the real bombs, and they are, you know, the Islamic radicals, and that is put on the back page of the paper, or lower down in your feed. What's put on the top of your feed or at the top of the news sites is what I believe are generally the staged or provocateur terror events that we're talking about. So is it predictive programming? I would think so. I'm just honestly surprised that we haven't seen more so-called militia, right-wing nationalist quote attacks, but that's probably as a result of the fact that the scoundrels, like, say, Hal Turner, who everybody knows now was an FBI asset, these guys are such scoundrels that they really end up ruining themselves. So I think they have a hard time finding people to commit these kinds of acts, and that's why they resort to, as you mentioned earlier, the lower disenfranchised socioeconomic status, be it the white guy who lives out in his trailer in Alabama, or the black guy who's in prison and goes into, you know, Nation of Islam or something like that. I mean, if you there's a good book on this by what's his name? It's called Prelude to Terror. James, I've got it somewhere here, but Prelude to Terror is a good book because it details another one of these incidents where you have a Nation of Islam guy who is connected to radicalism and Al-Qaeda down the road, David Salahuddin, and he's actually an FBI. He gets used by the FBI in one of these terror plots, and so this has been going on for a long time, is my point, you know, all the way back to, well, actually it goes back to ancient times. I know I'm rambling, but I think this is an important thing to remember, too, is that this is not just the purview of CIA assets and CIA case officers and operatives in foreign countries or FBI handlers in the U.S. It's really also done at the local level when police have confidential informants that go into gangs or drug networks or anything like that. It's all the same tactics of human psychology manipulation. So is it predictive programming? It's kind of predictive programming, and I would expect that we will see narratives spun of, you know, the homegrown white guy disenfranchised trailer terrorist.
It is interesting as to exactly how the predictive programming is working. And I think that what I was trying to flesh out before, I mean, I sort of lost my train of thought for a moment there, but it's because it is a little confusing, you know, because, again, on one hand, they're saying that these events are staged, essentially, you know, that they are provocateured by government intelligence agents. And on the other hand, they're saying that the groups involved in these things, are essentially, you know, I've got a real cause to fight. And so if you're coming from one of the demographics, like, say, you know, one of these, you know, white supremacist groups, then your cause is essentially being I guess, authenticated through a film like this, but at the same time, you're kind of being told that, you know, if you would go ahead and do anything, you're going to get stung, or that, you know, that this is how the system works. The system is using you and trying to set you up for, to, you know, for a much bigger agenda. So, yeah, I think that's what I was trying to get at before, is that I do agree that the predictive programming elements in this, but exactly what messages are being put across to what demographics is, I think, a little murky. But if nothing else, I think the predictive programming element that is most strong in this is that these things, you know, are happening, will happen, and this is kind of how they happen. So yeah. As to whether that's going to encourage or deter people, again, it's kind of a little bit confusing.
It's a little bit of something for everybody, and you work both sides of the aisle. And like any piece of art, the viewer or listener takes away from that what they want from it. You know what I mean? So there's cognitive bias for everybody who goes in there. So, you know, as an artist filmmaker, if you're real smart, you're like, hey, I'm going to work everybody on all sides of this issue here. And if you're real good, you can actually pull that off.
Well, it's funny because this is what they keep saying over and over again in the film, is that we see what we want to see. I think they say that at the beginning and the middle and the end of the film, we see what we want to see. And so I think this is almost speaking to the viewer. It's like kind of like they're breaking the fourth wall almost for a moment there and saying that you, the viewer, the audience will see what you want to see depending upon your biases and your history and your background and that kind of thing. So yeah, they are really giving something for everybody. And I think that's probably one of the most mysterious parts of the film.
Well, I think that it's weird that the film has a consistent presentation of race war that comes up several times. And ironically, if you look at the history of COINTELPRO, which was involved in, again, infiltrating not just the radical, say, leftist or Black Panther or Black nationalist groups, but it was involved in any kind of radical groups, right or left. And it involved, you know, immense amounts of provocateuring and, again, creating and fostering and kind of becoming a laboratory for the creation of the terror threat. And I think also when you look at the character of Manson, I more and more come to see Manson himself as a kind of psyop and a kind of character. I'm not saying he's not a nut and that he didn't do criminal things or arrange criminal actions through conspiracy. I'm not saying that, but I think that when you look at his background and what all he got involved in, especially his time period in prison, being achieving supposedly high level clear theta status of Scientology, and then later he comes out to be this, you know, completely brainwashed weirdo who plays this kind of role of on a Hollywood set, the Spawn Ranch, where they used to film spaghetti westerns. Well, I don't guess they'd be spaghetti westerns, but B-westerns, basically. Here he is hanging out on this old movie set, you know, tripping acid and basically gathering this little commune of followers around him, and he starts preaching race war. I would suggest that he probably had handlers in some kind of, you know, deep state, dark side of the CIA setting or something like that, by which this idea of the serial killer is then kind of, or the pseudo serial killer, sociopath, because he didn't actually commit the murders, you know what I mean, in the background. And then this sets off this whole idea of both the serial killer and the idea of the race war. Now, I mean, granted, there are already ideas of racial tension with integration and civil rights, things like that, but the idea of the, you know, the race war, and then, you know, this coming out of these shady, sketchy CIA-connected organizations like the Process Church, the Final Judgment, and all that, and that has connections to Scientology as well, with Robert de Grimston. I think that suggests a bigger kind of psyop, and I think Dave McGowan's right, you know, when he talks about this in Program to Kill, of not just the serial killer thing, but in my opinion, also the idea of the race war. So the race war is something that the establishment, and I don't mean like the local, you know, the FBI offices or I'm saying at the higher levels of the think tanks and the Pentagon and the social engineering aspects of things, the NGOs. I think that the race war, the Ford Foundation, or these foundations as well, that's who is interested in moving the culture in a certain direction and creating this polarization, factionalism, fringe movements, and then kind of, you know, managing them and moving them in whatever direction that the overall establishment wants.
Yeah, it's Manson, as he's saying, he didn't actually do anything himself, but he's famous for actually doing those things, you know? he's an entertainer. He was a musician, right? So that's really what he was. And in this film, you get the Dallas Wolf radio show host, who admits that, yes, I'm an entertainer. And he says, I tell these jackasses what they want to hear, and that's it. And, you know, the FBI brings him in, and they're like, hey, look, we got you now. And I was like, hey, look, look, I didn't do anything. You don't have anything on me. I'm just an entertainer, and that's all. Where before, it seemed like, you know, he was the ringleader, but he certainly wasn't. Anytime he ever responded to anybody was when they were talking about how they could get better ratings, you know, Radcliffe comes up to him. I've got investors, they've got a good marketing plan for you, and he gives them attention. But as soon as, like, that breaks off or that gets sketchy, Dallas Wolf takes him right out. And again, the FBI gets him in, nothing there. So that's kind of like the same thing going on there.
One quick point. I'm sorry, Adam. I just want to make one point that occurred to me is that in my perspective, from my research, if this movie were real, if we were going to see the real story of how this might in the real world go down, Daniel Radcliffe's character and Dallas Wolf would both be assets who would be provocateuring and, kind of informing. I think that's a more real-world scenario, especially when, this guy's like carbon copy of Hal Turner.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was going to say, actually. This Dallas Wolf character, who is the kind of patriarch, their leader, all the different levels of the whole network are looking toward this guy as some kind of messiah who's, speaking the truth and giving the gospel and all this kind of stuff. And yet, when it actually comes down to, what are your convictions, when the net character, Daniel Radcliffe, tries to approach him and say, look, I've got contacts, we want to take direct action, are you interested, what can you do for us? He's like, mate, get lost, I'm not interested. And it was actually him that approaches the FBI immediately after that and says, hey, this is a nut job. Who's been approaching me, and trying to get me to go along with something. I just want you guys to know that I'm not interested. But I think you're right, Jay, and this is exactly what I was going to say, that, in a real-world scenario, the Dallas Wolf character would be, an agent himself, possibly working with with the main character. But, at the same time, it is still relatively true to form in that he is basically just a cynical opportunist. He's doing it for fame, he's doing it for money. As you say, he's an entertainer, that's always really interested in. And this, of course, rings of so many of these famous pundits, not just on the right, but on the left as well. And, people following these people, they get the talking points and get fed their narratives from all these pundits. And yet when it actually comes down to, what are the, the true convictions of these people, what are they interested in, It's basically themselves.
And how much more so on the left? I mean, I'm not knocking the criticism of the so-called right. I mean, I seriously doubt Rush Limbaugh when he's hanging out at the golf courses is that concerned with the middle-class Americans who are, dealing with Obamacare. Rush Limbaugh's got 23 million listeners a night. I mean, I don't think he cares about middle-class America and, millions of dollars and whatever contracts he has. He's set. But on the left, it's even more hypocritical because the left is always quite consistently critical of wealthy persons. And then when you look at who funds most of leftism and progressivism, or if you look at the Hollywood liberals or whoever, we get the champagne socialist, the person who lives in a gated community, who's always talking about civil rights and Black Lives Matter, but who I seriously doubt has ever gone through the ghetto.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, these are all people like Michael Moore, tying into Soros, and these are all linked in with, massive think tanks and foundations like Carlyle Group and stuff like that, So, I mean, it's pretty comical already when you look at it. Bill Maher, all these titles.
Oh yeah, great. Really ridiculous.
He's in it for all the right reasons, Bill Maher. All right.
Oh boy, give him a break.
Yeah, come on, he's a good guy. I'm being sarcastic. Sorry about that. Well, what about this, Jay? They kind of use some, or they allude to the fact that these white supremacists scientists are conspiracy theorists. In fact, one of the FBI guys handling the case at the top back at the office says that. Like, oh, yeah, they're a bunch of conspiracy theorists. We don't have to worry about them. They're just a bunch of nut jobs. And then, what is his name? Dallas Wolf, again, uses the term white genocide, a term that's popular in alternative media. Do you think that this film is trying to paint alternative people who may not easily be equated with neo-Nazis, that they're painting that picture? Or what do you think is going on there?
Well, that's interesting because I know a lot of people on the alt-right, and it's interesting that, you know, Hillary Clinton, and just, I think, last night addressed the alt-right. And what did she do? Well, she did the very thing that you're talking about that this film does, is she grouped the alt-right together with conspiracy theorists and Alex Jones. So whether you like or don't like Alex Jones, or like or don't like the alt-right, the purpose of that speech was, of course, just merely a propagandist attempt to, you know, class everyone together in some sort of, you know, again, basically just make it all look distasteful. Now, that's pretty rich coming from Hillary, and, you know, the scandals of the Clinton dynasty. But it's also pretty ironic too, considering Hillary Clinton has openly said her mentor was Robert Byrd, who was a Grand Dragon for many years. I'm not here to make this into a left-right thing, because I'm not that interested in Donald Trump. I'm just saying that it's pretty comical, really, the theatrics of the whole pageant. But to answer your question, yeah, I think there is pretty much always a kind of desire on the part of the establishment to, you know, castigate anything that questions the establishment as conspiracy theory. And as I'm sure you guys know, you know, that comes out of the whole JFK thing, with the CIA creating the term conspiracy theory for anybody who didn't, you know, buy the official line on JFK. And so that throwaway term is just always, you know, put out there. But I think that they are a little worried about that, because they wouldn't be so busy, you know, kind of demonizing and doing logical fallacies and red herrings if the internet wasn't, you know, getting people to. I'm not like buying into a real like mass awakening. I don't think that's really the stage we're at yet, but it is interesting that, you know, Hillary is having in her mind to address these issues in her campaign and try to tie them all together. And I'm not promoting Alex Jones or anything like that. I think that was more of a just, again, an attempt to kind of demonize anybody who doesn't like Hillary, to put them all into one camp. You know, if you question anything about the Democratic status quo, well, then you've got to be a racist, you've got to be a Trump supporter, you've got to be an alt-righter, you've got to be conspiracy theorist, Alex Jones listener. You know, it's just these kind of really, really dumbed down, simplistic approaches. And that's pretty much what Hillary's audience is anyway, I guess you could argue the majority of Americans. But at the same time, you know, people are tending to, in some degree, wake up to these kinds of things, and that's why they're having to address it.
Well, I mean, what do you think about the just the whole spectrum of people that are shown in the film Imperium, because and how that relates to, I guess, the kind of the pigeonholing or the grouping together of, I guess, broad nationalist or ethno-nationalist type causes? Because in the film, what we do see is at the very bottom, when Nate is first making his inroads into this network, he's dealing with these kind of skinhead street thugs. So these people are, you know, like disenfranchised youth. They're largely uneducated, fairly ignorant, pretty stupid. You know, they're kind of going around, you know, causing trouble on the streets and all that kind of thing. Then, we move up very slightly to the slightly more educated kind of skinhead groups, and then they're kind of tied in into the kind of, I guess, what you might call libertarian type militias or some kind of far right militia type groups. And then, in addition to them, we also see, I guess, a little bit further up the food chain, the super conservative kind of highly educated family men, you know, who are, you know, completely non-violent, very, very friendly, very, very civilized, etc. And I guess
I think the name of the guy, but he reminded me a lot of somebody like, say, David Duke or Kevin MacDonald or somebody like that. And these are the people, as I said before, the most ostensibly peaceful people within this whole network are, in fact, the terrorists, or at least shown to be the terrorists, even though they have been guided, encouraged, and provoked into doing it. So, yeah, I mean, what is there to say about the kind of whole hierarchy or structure of this kind of wider network in terms of how that might be trying to paint that kind of broader set of causes relating to, you know, relating to conservatism, relating to nationalism, and, you know, some of the other issues that kind of go along with that?
Yes, excuse me.
Yeah, sorry, Jay.
Yeah, that's good. that's a good question. I remember one time I wrote an article about false flags, I think, in relation to the Paris incident. And Kevin MacDonald, I think, retweeted at me that I was a retard. So I don't think Kevin MacDonald's a big fan of anything I talk about. But this is interesting because I have done a lot of research on these topics. I think in 2007 or 8, I read both David Duke's book and I read Imperium. And Imperium is interesting because that's the title of the film. And that's a book by a guy named Francis Parker Yockey. I read the whole 700-page book. And I guess you could call it kind of the most recent major defense or treatise for fascism. So that would be my guess why the film has that name. And I think if you understand what that book argues, you can get a better picture of what the film's maybe going for. In Yockey's book, he basically argues that the entire history of the 20th century really represents a triumph of so-called democracy that was a tragedy insofar as fascism should have won. So I'm not saying that I agree with Yockey because I don't think that I think fascism is kind of a dead and gone philosophy. I don't think that is. I mean, depending on how wide you want. I mean, like national fascism is not really a thing that's going to ever come back to run the world. But Yockey was certainly the 20th century's, I guess, most erudite defender of that philosophy. And it's not, it's kind of ethno-nationalism, I guess you could say, his treatise at least. It's not so much in the vein of David Duke, where it's primarily racially based. Yockey's theory would be more on the line of a kind of spiritual hierarchy, maybe having a precedence over biology. And so what you get with somebody like David Duke would be more along the lines of a race or a biological supremacism, I guess is the best way to put it. That would be the difference between those two. So there is a divergence there in different ideas. just a little side note, there's an interesting piece critiquing this view as well from a guy named Kerry Bolton. I'm not advocating everything that Kerry Bolton says, but he did write a good essay called Rightist Critique of Racial Biologicalism or something to that effect. You can find the essay, but maybe I'll put it in the notes. But he makes some interesting points that distinguish this view. And one last kind of big scale geopolitical thinker I'll mention, and you'll see why I'm saying all this. Is Alexander Dugin. I did do an interview with Dugin that I think is relevant because Dugin's theory is that, and he's kind of he's Putin's advisor. His view is that we've had three phases of political philosophy in the last few centuries, and that they've kind of gone through stages and had their attempt at survival and then died. And so the first, he says, is classical liberalism, which would be kind of individualistic. Autonomy, the ideas that come out of, say, Adam Smith, Bentham, Locke, right out of the Enlightenment, laissez-faire and so forth. And we had a period of communism, which focused on class warfare, and then we had fascism, which focused on either race or nation. And in his analysis of the big scale progression, those the last two have died, and basically liberalism won. And so the 20th century kind of represents the victory of liberalism, and that jibes with what Quigley says as well. Quigley is, of course, the defender of Western so-called democracy basically populating the globe. I tend to agree with Dugin in this aspect of things, that nationalism
is kind of an older liberal movement out of the French Revolution, is where we get modern nationalism. Back then it was liberalism that was kind of replacing the ideas of medieval feudalism. And then, of course, you get industrialization, and that was a big part of nationalism as well. But in Dugin's analysis, we are pretty much living in the liberal order, which more or less comes out of Washington every day. So Washington representing this so-called democracy, which, again, is intent on exporting, quote, Western liberalism across the globe. And this shows the inherent contradiction of liberalism insofar as it does not allow for any other positions. And so, for example, you might have in, say, the Middle East, something like Arab nationalism or something, a sort of a moderate Islamic regime or something like that. It has to go because of the dictates and the internal logic of liberalism itself. And so because it's a kind of self-destructive philosophy in that it negates all larger groupings or metaphysical classifications such as nation, gender, or race, which is what we're seeing now, what it results in is ultimately the denial of the human. And so that's where we are in his view, and I would tend to agree with that. And the reason I say all that is because you are seeing, I think, a reaction against globalism in, say, the European New Right, or in Middle Eastern countries, or with Russia, or with Assad. These reactions to the West are reactions to, ultimately, the philosophy of Western liberalism. And I also tend to agree that Western liberalism is not really liberal. It's actually a kind of liberal tyranny. And I'm using liberal in the classical sense, not in the modern American left-right sense at all. And so, therefore, the film that we're talking about, Imperium, I think represents the film version of that contradiction insofar as the idea is that, fascism is bad, and we've just shown you in this film. Yet when you consider the actions of the FBI in the film, the actions of the FBI are completely totalitarian and fascist. And that's, I think, the underlying bold-faced contradiction of Western so-called democracy is, in fact, to, on the one hand, tell you it's Orwellian, right? I mean, at least, I'm not pro-fascist at all. I think fascism in the 20th century is created and funded by the West, according to, you know, Carol Quigley or Anthony Sutton. But in fact, with fascism, you know what you're getting. with democracy, you get told you're free on the one hand, as Huxley says, and then on the other hand, you're getting, you know, I was just reading Quigley talking about when I'm not joking, he says this, when the Axis powers were defeated, the Allied forces moved in, he says, the Allied forces set up a temporary, they set up a provisional military police state to ensure democracy. A provisional military police state that will ensure democracy. I mean, that's total Orwellianism there. So while fascism and communism, I think, are dreadful, the sad fact is that I would agree with Plato that the worst, unfortunately, can be the insidious deception and two-facedness of so-called democracy.
Yeah, well, Western liberal democracy, at least, because this is what people are getting so frustrated with, and this is why we have, you know, massive support for people like Trump. This is why we have this sort of this rise in ethno-nationalism across Europe with the sort of far-right movements over there, and possibly why we're now seeing films like this as well. This is because of this, you know, rising tide of, yeah, dissatisfaction with this kind of, people, you know, traditionally refer to it as like cultural Marxism is, I guess, one way of describing it, or there's one aspect of it, you know. But it's, as you say, it's the elimination of all ideological opposition, you know, in order to reduce man down to something that is completely material. You know, just like I think you used the term materialist ethics or something like that, which is essentially what it is. You know, it gets rid of it's reductionist. It gets rid of man's spirit. It gets rid of any questions of metaphysics. Although it is kind of, as you said, presupposed on the metaphysical basis in the first place. Anyway, exactly. But this, you know, a lot of people are obviously
I think that in the mainstream, I'm not going to think that in such these, you know, philosophical terms, but the energy is there, the energy, because people, you know, people look at this stuff and, you know, I think fundamentally see it as whatever it is. It's contradictory, you know, it's completely self-effacing in terms of what we would, you know, what we all say are shared human values. And so, yeah, it's a very, very interesting phenomenon. And this is why, you know, it's good to talk about films like Deconstruct and, you know, go back and forth on some of these arguments, because, I mean, I'm much the same, you know, I don't buy into to left or right, but I think it's important to, you know, to talk through these issues and not simply say that, you know, fascism is nasty and bad and liberalism is happy and good, you know, so, yeah.
I just thought something in terms of the film, they could use it as an experiment, just on like a focus group level, or, you know, testing based on, you know, chatter, people talking on the internet, you know, just gauge people's reaction and see, you know, if they side, who they side with in this film. And if people are saying, oh, yeah, if they side with the protagonist, which is Radcliffe and the FBI ostensibly, see if that works, even given the objective reality within the film that they're being nasty and they're fooling people into doing something that they wouldn't have done were it not for this FBI presence. You know what I mean? So what will the reaction be? Will people be like, oh, yeah, yeah, because he's a protagonist, I still side with him. So I don't know. It's a social experiment side of those things. But did you have any more questions for Jay, Adam?
I think more than anything else, just to, I guess, talk about, I mean, we have been talking about this already, but I guess just kind of finish up and touch on the broader relevance of something like this film. And I think, Jay, you have, you know, given us a few references in the lead up to the discussion here. We talked about Mike German, you know, who was a consultant for this film, and we'll put plenty of links in the show notes, you know,
yeah,
he was an FBI.
It was the Brennan Center, sorry, I meant to mention
Center,
yeah.
Yeah. He's also, I mean, I did a bit of looking up on him today, and he's also kind of tied to like Democracy Now and some other kind of source funded institutes, so that's interesting too. So there are sort of there are a few threads to look into there in terms of the background of this film being tied to, I guess, what you might call the liberal establishment, which is interesting because when we talk about the idea of, you know, liberalism having to defeat any ideological opposition whatsoever, and the whole concept of, you know, them talking about diversity when they actually mean the very opposite of that, about eliminating diversity, it is interesting because at the beginning of the film, that is what we see. Well, what we see is them getting some very, well, I suppose relatively shady kind of signals intelligence or human intelligence on, you know, potential, you know, terrorist plot within these right-wing networks. But what they do is they go looking for them, you know, and although they're saying, oh, we see what we want to see, and we, you know, that's in there, they do actually actively find out, actively speak out and find these groups and guide them towards their own agenda so that they can spoil them, you know, and so I think it kind of ties into the whole idea of this being, yeah, I guess in some ways a kind of a hit piece against, you know, conservatism and against right-wing demographics, because the default position of the FBI in this film is liberal, you know, and we do see that come through in the script in a number of places. We've got the consultant, Mike German, having been tied to these, you know, sort of left-wing policy institutes, and then we've got the plot of the film basically seeking out these people so that they can eliminate them. So I think that's interesting to talk about, but I guess we've covered most of that already, but I mean, I guess in closing, Jay, I mean, what would you sort of, I don't know, what would you say this film is about? What in terms of the demographics that are going to be looking at this film and how they're most likely going to be reacting, what do you think the desired response or the desired set of responses would most likely be?
Yeah, it could be partly used as a way to gauge chatter and reaction. I definitely think that goes on with a lot of the, you know, things that the NSA does and different private groups that are tied into the NSA that, you know, work with supercomputers and things like that. I remember, you know, back at the time of the kerfluffle of Jade Helm, I wrote several articles saying that I didn't think that was anything real, other than it did appear to be connected to, you know, kind of military wargaming operations to watch people's chatter, you know, and how they reacted to this PSYOP. I think the whole thing was really just a PSYOP. So there certainly could be an aspect of this film which could relate to that. Maybe, you know, testing to see what. Yeah, radicals, maybe. I don't know if the film would really provoke much, but I do think we're going to continue to see, you know, the trend of the right grow and nationalism grow, especially in Europe. You've got, you know, Le Pen and the National Front that's continually growing. You've got movements in Germany. You've got Golden Dawn in Greece. These groups are going to continue to swell in numbers, mainly just because of the ridiculous policies of the EU when they openly say they want to use mass immigration to destroy the existing structures, you know, be they good or bad. That is what they explicitly say. Now, I, you know, tend to disagree with the alt-right on the very question of these kinds of events and to what degree they're real and provocateur and staged. And so I think the, I guess you could call them the alternative research community or whatever terms we want to use that continues to stretch false flag. I almost always agree with that. I think that's usually what's going on in these cases. And so, for example, as I've said many times in recent interviews, when it comes to the situation in Europe that's kind of causing the reaction of the right in terms of the immigrants, the migrant crisis, and so forth, you have to understand NATO's operations in Syria. That's partly the cause of that, and that's backed by the same Western Soros State Department. And so Soros he benefits in two ways from this, because on the one hand, he gets the immigrants where he brags and says, well, Europe's not replacing its population, so I'm just bringing you people to do the jobs and replace the population anyway. And admittedly, he says, you know, he wants to destroy the existing state of Europe. As well as Peter Sutherland, another EU bureaucrat and banker, who says that migrant populations can be weaponized as a form of warfare. There's, you know, college papers on Oxford, Princeton papers on that very thing. Kelly Brown, I think is her name. Kelly somebody has a whole paper on that, but a policy paper, I'm saying. And so to understand the migrant situation, once you understand both sides of that issue, you know, if you were to say, look at somebody like Patrick Henningsen that I work with and the way he discusses the Syria situation, which he's covered intently for the last 2 years. In fact, we had one of our writers at 21 Wire actually met with Assad a couple weeks ago. And so I think if you look at her research, particularly on the white helmets and what's going on in Syria, I would say if people on the right or the alt-right understood what she's writing, and then conversely, people on maybe the more Sabell or Vanessa Bealey or the Patrick side of things understood what the concerns of the right in Europe are, we could see that both sides have aspects of truth, but both sides might be a little bit blind to the bigger game that somebody like, say, a Soros or the State Department can be playing, in that they benefit from both sides of this. You see what I'm saying? And I'm not saying, by the way, that means that the terror attacks are all real. I don't believe they are. I believe they're, be it France, be it Charlie Hebdo, be it Dallas, I believe most of these are either provocateur or staged, or Orlando. And so, you know, like, you know, the alt-right hopped on Orlando right away. And, you know, no questioning of that event, that really bugged me. You know, Henrik and I had a civil, I think, disagreement over that issue. But my message would be that both sides of this research community could, I think, get insight from the other side, and then we would see kind of the bigger globalist oligarchs playing both sides of that. That's my opinion.
Yeah, I think that's absolutely correct, and I would hope for that. And I think this is what we try and do on this show as well, is just rather than buying into the reactionary one side or the other, you know, left wing good, right wing good, left wing bad kind of narrative that's going around, and trying to, yeah, look at things a little bit more prosaically from a, you know,
from a bit more of a distance and then try and look at the bigger picture. Because, again, as you said, both sides have elements of truth. And as the director of this film says, you know, dehumanizing people and ignoring what they have to say altogether doesn't do anything for anybody. But, I mean, I think just finishing up on, in terms of my comments there, I think that if I was to put this film down to kind of any one agenda or purpose, I think I would agree in that I think gauging the response, and we've talked about this in a number of previous podcasts where we talk about how films like this are put out there to literally just see what different demographics within the population are going to say about it and how they're going to respond. And I mean, this is something that is a lot of money and time and resources are put into in places like DARPA and the CIA and all these cyber ops kind of operation centers is what they call narrative networks, you know, creating narratives, nudging narratives, building them, twisting them, sort of diverting them off in different directions. And I think something like the general kind of alt-right / far-right kind of cause is something that they're going to be looking at pretty closely right now. And I think a film like this is going to be part of that, absolutely. So Aaron, did you have any other questions or comments?
No, not really. Like you guys, I think that this is just, again, something, little something for everybody, and the watchers are watching to see what everybody's reaction is, and, you know, they just push things further as they always do. And that's about it. But Jay, why don't you tell our listeners where they can find your material, any interesting stuff you might have coming up?
I would, again, also recommend, I debated one of the guys on the alt-right named Roman Bernard. He was very, very rude in that debate, but there's a debate you can find with me and Roman Bernard on this very topic. It's a Boiler Room episode that we did, which is a podcast that I go on pretty regular. It's about, I don't know, 6 months ago, but you can find if you Google Jay versus Roman Bernard, where we debate that the very topic we're discussing, you know, in terms of geopolitics and alt-right and Islam and false flags, for about an hour and a half straight. So that you can check that out for that topic if you want more on that, as well as debates or civil disagreements that I had with Henrik at Red Ice. But if people are interested, I do lectures on philosophy. I did the totality of Plato's Republic. And so basically, you know, the first hour free, the second hour is based on subscription. And then now several lectures deep into Carol Quigley's Tragedy and Hope, about 800 pages in now. So we're going to cover the entirety of the book. And we're five lectures deep, and the next one will be World War II. Also, you know, subscription-based as well, be $4.95 a month or $60 a year. And then my book will be out in a couple months called Esoteric Hollywood, Sex, Cults, and Symbols in Film, which isn't a scandal book. It's, if you've ever read any of the Jay's Analysis film reviews, they're, you know, dealing with philosophy, geopolitics, symbolism, you know, that kind of stuff, different directors, and what the messages are, not just in a conspiracy sense, but, you know, it could be geopolitics, it could be, you know, what's the alien propaganda from Spielberg, what's Kubrick saying in The Shining, what's, you know, what's this 007 film based on, is it based on something real? So that's what you get with Esoteric Hollywood, and you can pick that up at Amazon or Trine Day Publishers.
Well, I would just like to encourage listeners to Jay's website at jaysanalysis.com. We can find all this, because I've been actually listening to the Tragedy and Hope series, because the book is extremely long and complicated, it's a beast of a book, and so to have a companion to go along with that and just to condense things a bit and to put them into context is actually really helpful. I would definitely recommend that. It's been fantastic having you on. We'll most definitely have to get you back on the show in the future for another, interview at some point. And I've really enjoyed it.
Absolutely. It's been a party. A mind party.
The
Prince 1999 party. That kind of party.
Thank you, everybody, for listening. And you can find themes and memes at tnpodcast.com. being sorts of different podcast aggregators on Twitter and follow them. And yeah, you can find the next episode there to keep listening. It was great to speak to you all of you guys today.
Absolutely, and it's been great times.
This interview was recorded on the 27th of August, 2016.